My name is Marta. I am a GLAM coordinator for Wikimedia Polska. And I would like to share some of my experiences with GLAM collaborations. But first, I have a quick question. How many of you have or are collaborating with a GLAM or are involved in a GLAM project?
Okay, everyone.
How about three GLAM projects at once?
Sure.
More than one at a time.
Alright.
This gives me an idea. Okay then, so you will understand me. So I wonder if you have had the same experiences with GLAM collaborations as I have had. 3 years of more or less starting projects and then trying to follow through with them and running them, some more, some less successfully, has kind of given me these ideas about, first of all, you have to start with yourself. If you want to run a successful collaboration with a cultural institution or any other kind of institution, really, you have to first think about the other side. So get to know them. In my case, I have a, let's say, museum background. I studied curating. So my most successful collaborations are with museums because I know how a museum works, more or less, what is important to people who work there. And I'm sure others who have more experience with archives or libraries are going to be better at running these sorts of projects. So you have to have some understanding of what are the priorities on the other side. It's also important to keep in touch. And Daria, who also does similar things, has said on other occasions that it's also good to have more than one person to talk to in a museum or a library in a GLAM institution, because you can always start with one enthusiastic person to kind of start things, but then someone may change jobs, someone may get sick or for any reason stop being available at an institution, and then, well, depending on how large the collaboration is, either this can be a small or a large problem, but it's better if over time, especially, there's more people in the institution who can sort of take over so that it doesn't sort of dwindle down. And then the methods of communication, obviously. I think generally some Wikipedians are very used to communicating in a certain way, only through Wikipedia or through certain software and not other kinds of software, and not through certain kinds of social media for ideological reasons. And I think it's quite good if we can be slightly more open to each other. If someone chooses to be using that, and not, it doesn't matter in the end. We can still carry out our core mission and enrich Wikipedia, but for sort of marginal things like which tool we are going to choose, let's just go with what our partner says. And then the real interest in working together at the beginning of trying to get in touch with several labs, I found that you can give your enthusiasm to the other side, but it won't necessarily last. So there's this period of observation where there's always a risk. Perhaps it's going to work out. Perhaps the employee of a GLAM that promises to the work is actually going to do it. But initially, we don't know. So we have to know, kind of watch our partner and see what they can do, and also realize what our community can do, how many people are interested in that particular project. And yes, generally active people make good partners, that's very true. This is the case, I think, of our partners from the Ethnographic Museum in Warsaw, where Clara is simply interested in getting the museum's content to many different places, online, offline, in generating all sorts of activity, And so collaborating with Wikimedia was just another activity that looked interesting, and she was ready to devote some time to explore that. So yeah, that was aimed mainly at beginners, which I'm not sure there are any in this room. But I think what helped in our case was having a sort of clear identity, creating that sort of glam landing page, creating lots of information at the beginning saying our mission as Wikimedia is this and that, which is why it goes together with the mission of many glam institutions, and placing that on a sub-page on Polish Wikipedia, creating all sorts of leaflets that explain why we are trying to get glam institutions on board. So whenever we are contacting a new organization, it's all there in our language, and they can understand quite clearly where we are coming from. This is an example of such a general information page that we can then print out and do lots of things with it. And then there is this particular level of being partners one-on-one. So the Wikipedian or the GLAM coordinator from the side of Wikimedia and a specific employee or person from the GLAM institution. And there, I think that clear communication is really important, because we both, the Wiki site and the museum site, we tend to speak in jargon. We tend to speak in that language spoken in our own group. And then it is not so easy to understand what the other side means once we kind of stop posturing and stop saying we are experts in our field and just try to get to what needs to be done. It's much easier. Which kind of ties into that respect, not arrogance point. And we had a very positive experience again, at the Ethnographic Museum in Warsaw, where we ran that sort of mutual training. We were showing the museum employees the basics of editing, the basics of Commons Upload, and so on. And then the museum employees have done this dry run of an ethnographic interview. So members of our community were kind of taken out of their comfort zone, and they posed as ethnographers asking questions, and they could visualize the environment in which they are going to be later on. So we have to remember, and I think it's a good thing to tell volunteers who are going to be working on GLAM projects, that both sides know things the other doesn't, and that we learn from each other, and this is not a one-way street. And then in order for projects to not dwindle down, to be successfully carried out, and then hopefully to have some sort of follow-up, it's good to plan at the start, to be realistic about what we can do. It depends on the project scale. If we only have one interested volunteer, that's fine, but we have to factor that in, that perhaps in that case, if you want to achieve a specific goal, such as a number of files on Commons, or a number of articles that we would like to see in Wikipedia, or both, or something else, then we need more time for that to happen, because perhaps this volunteer isn't going to be able to find other people online to collaborate. Perhaps there will be interest, but maybe not. So it's good to have a timeline, even if there is no budget, even if, well, we could just sort of see what happens, but then what frequently happens is nothing. So I think it's good to have an idea about scale, and of course there are all these models that anyone can put together and take elements from different models of land projects that have been carried out everywhere. So small scale ones, or these larger ones, and especially for the larger ones. I'm trying to decide which slide to show you first. Right, let's go back to that for a second. For these larger ones, it matters a lot more because they may involve a large group of people who need to be somehow coordinated, and things might need to happen in order, in sequence. And money might be involved. In our case, we received up to this point, museums with which Wikimedia Polska collaborated have received 3 or 4 grants from the Polish Ministry of Culture. And then Wikimedia is a partner in that specific project that was funded. So obviously we have a responsibility to deliver what has been stated in the original proposal. So that is a factor. And obviously if we are very enthusiastic at the beginning, even if a project doesn't involve any money, but we have gone to a number of people and really tried to convince them that this is great, please come, we are going to organize several meetings, this is going to happen, then again, it's something that needs more attention because we don't want to lose all these volunteers once they have, for example, physically traveled from place to place to attend a workshop, to attend a meeting, and so on. So out of the larger projects that we carried out last year, apart from the ritual year of Wikipedia and the Carpathian project, the most successful one was the Faras Wiki project, which was one of several projects done with the National Museum in Warsaw. And that was the first museum in Poland that decided to hire a Wikipedian residence, initially for this 3-month test period. We also decided together that the Wikipedian in residence is going to be training a group of students who are going to be learning about the museum and about Wikipedia and writing articles initially about pastel exhibition, which was nice because these pastels cannot be displayed permanently in the museum. They are normally hidden in the archives. So the museum uploaded a certain number of these pastels to Wikimedia Commons. We had new articles about them. And this way they are present in the digital space, and they already have been hidden in the archives after that short time temporary show. So that was the first project, and after that we adopted the same system again on a slightly larger scale to again invite students, invite some specialists, and together write articles about the Faras Gallery at the National Museum. And actually the number of articles and the number of images wasn't breathtaking. The articles were about 25 articles in Polish, and then the overall number of articles is something like 70, because then they got translated into several other languages. I think there is a list here on the. Those are screenshots from a kind of presentation page that we make for projects that are at some more advanced stages of development, so that then it's very easy to send emails to promote it, to invite more people, because it is not a wiki project, it's a separate page that is a description of what we're doing. And I find that really helpful. I'm not sure it's done that often in that way to kind of make it look pretty, but it encourages people. But the number of articles, number of images wasn't extortionate. However, the quality of articles was really, really high. Some volunteers wrote really long articles that were very well referenced, that were not an essay, but very, very comprehensive work. And then these articles got reviewed by one of the curators of that gallery. And I asked the curator at the end of the project, well, how was it? What do you think? And she said, well, yes, I was checking these articles before making them public on from the Sandbox to Wikipedia. And it was a lot of words. Sometimes I had to correct the style and the language, and sometimes the structure was wrong, and sometimes they got their facts wrong, and I had to find references for them and help them on to a really good article. So they're complaining and complaining, and then she, but that was the best thing I've ever done. So we had articles, we had images, and then we went a little bit crazy and decided to, together with the museum, decided to organize a conference for other GLEM professionals about this project and also about sharing your work as a museum in an open way in the context of Wikipedia and other open projects. And we also published this sort of magazine. So we did a lot. And I think it was good because later on we were invited there. And we also got an award. This is annual awards for the most innovative projects in Polish museums. And so we got a second prize in the digitization category for that project, which shows, I think, that quality is also a huge factor, and it kind of, the quantity that is one of the main measures of success in media, and obviously it's important, but quantity of things that are produced, it kind of springs from quality, because if you want something that is high quality, then you will have to correct that description, and you will have to go there and fix that, and things begin growing, even if your initial plan was quite small. Right. So there it is, quantity versus quality, the eternal struggle, and I realized that both are very important.
But quality is the more important, most important. I think so.
Well, yes, but you need both. However, I think if you decide to run a project that is narrower, then potentially the people are going to be more motivated because you will get real enthusiasts who are going to... Well, people who were working on that first project cared about those articles. They cared that the illustrations are good, they wanted to produce that publication. They wanted to do it for free because they started caring about the output. And I think very often this is the GLEM way. The way that many museums, especially I think, operate is they are very meticulous about how things look, about images, about editing, about kind of the final product, and it's not a product in a commercial sense, it's what people get to see, to present culture in the best possible way. And perhaps it's something for organizers of GLEM projects to consider, I'm not really sure, but there you have it. And our kind of core business is transferring those skills to the GLEM. Whatever project we decide to run, in the end, after a year, after 2 years, hopefully people who have been working with us are able to do it on their own. Which is, I think, what has happened really at the National Museum in Warsaw and the Ethnographic Museum and in some other places. And also what was being said yesterday at another presentation, follow-up is a good thing. This is what we are trying to generate. One, not just to a showy project that people are going to like, and obviously it creates content for Wikimedia, but also hopefully once we have that wiki project in place and the work has been done, we have a network of people who are going to carry on even though the funding is not there anymore, even though some part of the work is done, there is always more work. And these people are interested in the subject, so yeah. So at the moment in Wikimedia Polska we have around 17 open grant collaborations. Obviously some of them kind of run themselves because there are those small scale ones where it's one employee at an archive just uploading files, or it's one volunteer at a museum coming over every now and then, perhaps teaching some students, but mainly taking photographs and editing. So obviously there are the little ones but also quite large projects. So at that point, it is quite imperative to begin choosing, because apart from the 17 already existing collaborations, we may have new organizations asking for help or interested in running another sort of thematic project like the one that I showed you before, then we have to choose the order in which this is going to be done, because we cannot promise everything to happen in the next year. The quality is going to decrease. So what priorities to adopt? Obviously, if there is interest and funding for some type of project, this is worth considering. It's worth considering the sort of grant projects that are likely to have interest inside the existing Wikimedia community, for which we don't have to go outside and look for students and look for new people to get involved, but already we know there is interest. Projects that have a large audience, so a large benefit for readers of Wikipedia. And again, where we know there are people in our community who are very good at this. Whether we have excellent photographers, so if someone offers us a great photo opportunity, then we want to do that because we know the output's going to be great. Or there are people who are good at, have any other skills, then obviously, and are available at the moment, we know, are willing to do it, then we have to prioritize according to who can help us. Going forward, my personal wish list is that we are going to have even better upload tools than the ones that exist already for real non-techies. So that at the moment, in my experience, even if some people at GLAM institutions in Poland have been trained in using PettyPen or using other upload tools, most of the most active partners of ours are uploading on the Commons Wizard because it is simple and they want to devote their time and intellectual efforts doing other things. It's a kind of generic problem that one always has to learn new skills in software, but still. I was wondering if, this isn't really a conversation for this room maybe, but for people who, like perhaps Wikimedia Slovakia or other countries where there aren't that many GLAM collaborations, we might have some kind of conversation with anyone from the foundation about helping to translate these memoranda of understanding, partnership agreements, because it needs to also conform to the legal situation in those countries, but it would, I think, really help these people to begin a conversation with larger cultural institutions. And sometimes, I think this is the case of Slovakia, the Slovakian National Gallery is already placing public domain symbols on its collection on the website. So they are aware of licensing issues of Creative Commons and so on. And it's just waiting to become official. So if they had this document to present to the Slovak National Gallery, I think it would just hit it off much more easily. Like I said earlier, this identity really helps. In Wikimedia Polska, we have currently this bottleneck with uploads, because there are a couple of institutions like the National Digital Archives and another GLAM institution that have files that could be uploaded to Commons, but it's a mass upload, and so there aren't that many people willing to do the work or having the skills. I find it very difficult. If there was more time and so on and so forth. So perhaps within CE it would be possible that, I'm not sure how often, once a year, maybe once every 6 months, organize some kind of upload-a-thon and speed this up. Participation in GLAM conferences is always good, where museums professionals meet, and then this happens in CE countries, so we're trying to do this here. And I believe this is it. Thank you very much. Please like us on Facebook.
And now we have... Oh, question?
Okay.
Oh, sorry. Small question / suggestion. A previous slide, but I'm from Wikimedia Netherlands, and we faced the same problem with the upload tool.
Yes,
it's kind of less complicated. And what we did was we set up a small training. It was just one afternoon for our serious GLAM partners, mm-hmm. learning them about the PettyPen tool, and it was one of the more successful meetings. So just providing training. So maybe you could use that idea.
Perhaps yes. I'm sure that in larger museums it could work. Then yeah. There's people from their digitization departments and
yeah.
maybe like 4 or 5.
So you mean you bring people from various museums in one place and
yeah. Yeah.
Okay. And show them how it works.
In Poland could be complicated just because of the size of the country.
Ah, yes.
And then the number of people we can invite, it might be quite large conference again. When this Faras idea was at the beginning the small, but then more and more GLAMs wanted to come, and we ended up with pretty large conference.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't want to pose a question, but to tell you something which I think is very important. First of all, thank you very much for your nice presentation. I write books on art and history, art history and general history, and last year I delivered some lectures at Indian universities. And I told the Indians, which they didn't know, that in Austria you have the largest collection of old Indian coins. You have the largest collection of old Indian textiles, because Rings by Game, the famous general who served the emperors and conquered the Turks, and regained Belgrade. He was an avid collector of garments, elegant garments from what is nowadays Gujarat, where the current Prime Minister Modi comes from, and. Let's say if you look at certain parts of India like Nagaland, if you want to explore the history, the art history of Nagaland, you have to come to Vienna, because at that time Nagaland was a colony, what would be nowadays impossible. There were Austrian scholars who went there and who collected a lot of fortunes, so they are in Vienna. So we have close cooperations with Indians. They come to our university of applied arts to study restoration of old textiles. They look at the old coins of our Naga culture. So the same would apply to your Carpathian project, because not far from our headquarters is the Museum of Volkskunst. There you find much more than you have in your digital collection nowadays. But the problem is policy, not policy. We must take into consideration policy, because I am 62 years of age. I know how it was in analog times. For instance, in Austria, we have 33,000 recognized monuments. We have an office for the protection of monuments, which is a part of the ministry. Yes, but what is the situation of formerly? They had paid photographers who were embedded in the office. They had a huge staff of scientists. Nowadays you have this neoliberal policy. They make budget cuts, they make cost cuts. So Wikipedia is very welcome to them, because they're unpaid volunteers. They organize some photo contests where we get two or three cameras, peanuts, you know. But they cancel their positions, the jobs of paid photographers, etc. So everything has two sides, and if we get too enthusiastic about these projects, then we have to take into consideration the negative consequences too. You know?
Yeah, it's always good to be realistic.
It's really
but, yeah,
I wish
it
was
really short.
You mentioned that it would be nice to translate to several languages your agreement, because it could help.
Yeah.
I think it could help, but as first step, it would help if it in English, because then
the English ones exist. I know that Daria has
then,
several templates.
Then
for
it would be easier if you help us. Where can we find the English version? And we can learn from it. Thank you.
Okay, we can do that actually. Thank you very much.